We will be talking about the global resource disparities in cervical cancer care, which has been very nicely elucidated by the first speaker. The abstract has been presented, and if we go through the data, the incidence of cervical cancer is twice as high in the developing world than in the developed world, and the mortality is three times as high. More than 85% of all cervical cancer deaths occur in low and middle resource countries. India, if you see the map, India is huge. There are a lot of cervical cancers happening. There are a lot of cervical cancer mortality. But the resources in India are also, they are not uniform. You have the highest end of surgical skills, surgical facilities, the best of chemo and targeted therapy, the best facilities in radiation therapy, two areas where there are none of these available. So my first question is to Dr. Tongaonkar. Do you agree with the ASTRO guidelines, sir? ASCO guidelines.
Can I have the mic?
To summarize, ASTRO guideline has provided evidence-based recommendations for four resource tiers, that is basic, limited, enhanced, and maximal.
Well, yes and no. You know, cervix cancer is known as the disease of unfortunate inequities, and that's exactly what it is. The ASCO guidelines have taken surgery very lightly. They said in basic, they say you can do surgery for CS cervix. In limited resource, you can do surgery for CS cervix. Extrafacial hysterectomy for stage 3B, etc. I don't think that's just feasible at all.
So can you just elaborate extrafacial hysterectomy for the audience who are not surgeons? We have a lot of radiation oncologists and medical oncologists in the audience. So can you just expand on extrafacial hysterectomy?
The standard treatment for a CA cervix, which is operable, that's stage 1B and 2A, is what you call a class 3 radical hysterectomy, where you go remove a lot of parametrium and you go through the ureteric tunnel. You know, you remain lateral to that, so it's called a type 3 or class 3 radical hysterectomy. Extrafacial is just sticking very close to the uterus, and that's called class 1. Actually, when the disease is outside the uterus, if you try and do a class 1 radical hysterectomy or extrafacial radical hysterectomy, you'll be cutting through the disease. Not only it's not possible to remove the whole disease, but the morbidity of the procedure will be tremendous. There will be a lot of bleeding, higher chance of fistulae. So I don't think surgery should be attempted also, not even considered for these patients. I can understand if it's an early stage disease. Yes, you can probably do an extrafacial hysterectomy, give radiation, not as a standard of care, but out of desperation. But I think even in basic this thing, I think radiation can be given. And that's what the government of India is thinking of, that in every district there should be a radiation facility available.
Dr. Sailashree, do you also agree with Dr. Tongaonkar on this issue?
Yes. The good part or the worst part of India is we have things coexisting. We have do everything versus do nothing. I don't think we're in a situation in India that we are in that minimal standard. Do something. That do something if it's dangerous to the patient. If you cut through the disease, apart from the morbidity, actually you might disseminate the disease. So I don't think we are doing any favor to anybody by operating on advanced stage cervical cancers. We have to send them somewhere. I'm sure we can send them somewhere in this country at least.
And on a more philosophical note, I think it sends a very wrong signal that on the pretext of low resource setting, yes, you can get away with anything. Yes. I don't think that's the message that we want to disseminate.
So, Dr. Reena Engineer, the machine gap. In India, the machine per million is 0.6 to 0.7 as compared to the developed world where it's 10 per million. Yeah. So, huge machine gap. We still need maybe 2,000 or 2,500 more linear accelerators to come to 3 per million. Do you think that is an unmanageable situation, or we have hubs enough for patients to be transported and treated? I'm talking about the ground realities of India. Radiation facilities. Do you think these guidelines, we can just pick them up and put in our setting, or you think there are some class solutions for Indian setting?
That's actually a difficult question, but yes, in certain like below, from Maharashtra to South India, the situation is slightly better compared to the Northeast and some part of North like Himachal Pradesh, and where there's absolutely no facilities. But then every attempt may be made to refer these patients to a basic cobalt units, because you don't need very high-end radiation for the, to treat these cases. And every state has a RCC, Regional Cancer Center, which has a cobalt machine. So I don't think it's impossible. And attempts should be made by these, and awareness should be also there.
Dr. Govind Babu, no chemo, no surgery. Give no radiation, no surgery. Give chemo to the patient. Is that the philosophy? Do you think we should encourage that?
I don't think so. In fact, ICMR has actually brought up guidelines. So I think that is more relevant to our country than following the ASCO guidelines.
Right. So I think the message is very clear. We should still try to give standard of care to the patient as much as possible. And we can have, in spite of being limited resource, we still have some resource in our country. And we can try to provide, if not optimal, but at least near optimal treatment to the patient. So I think the message from this abstract is very clear, that we need to follow our guidelines. Maybe we need to formulate our guidelines rather than blindly following ASCO guidelines. I think this has been discussed, so I will just skip all this. Role of neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery. Dr. Sudeep Gupta is not there in the house, right? Because he is the PI in the NSCT trial.
I have been associated with that.
Almost everybody is involved in it.
So this is talking about the EORTC trial, NSCT. I think it has been very nicely described, so I will not get into the details of the trial. Chemotherapy followed by surgery versus concomitant chemo radiation therapy. If we go into the nitty-gritties of trial, even in the chemotherapy followed by surgery arm, there were certain characters where they had advocated radiation after surgery. The early results of EORTC trial, of course the final results are going to come in 2019, but the early results in 2016 showed that a lot of patients could not complete their main treatment, surgery. Almost one-third of the patient, because of chemotherapy-related toxicity. Do you think we are pushing it a bit too hard? My question is to Dr. Sairam. Are we pushing it a bit too hard and trying to do something where, you know, evidence stares at us at blankly and say, no, this is the standard of care, and we are just trying to snatch it away from there and trying to do something different? Or do you think this has a merit to do neoadjuvant chemotherapy followed by surgery? Do you think it has a merit?
That a lot of trials have been withheld in between finding negative results of neoadjuvant chemotherapy. So I think probably cervical cancer should be treated as primarily, first we should address the local disease, then consider for any form of chemotherapy.
Fine. So Dr. Tongaokar, your comments on?
Well, I think if you look at the patient, patients who have been included in this trial, they are 1B2, 2A2 and 2B. So they are high volume disease, where the survivals are not great, about 60-65%. And in cervical cancer, I think that's much lesser than what one would expect. So an attempt was made to see whether any other modality, especially chemotherapy, could be incorporated in the treatment paradigm and get better results. And when we actually thought of this trial first, the EORTC had just started, and for a year they could not enroll even a single patient. So we had given them the offer that we'll probably do it together, but their methodology is different. They're only using cisplatin, we are using paclitaxel plus cisplatin. But I think it is well worth trying, because in any solid tumor, surgery has an important role to play. So probably incorporation of surgery after neoadjuvant chemotherapy, even in 2B, may improve survival.
No, what one factor in the design of the EORTC trial was radiation was assessed after surgical pathology. It did not take into account the neoadjuvant status of the tumor, and that was worrisome. Do you have any comment on that?
Well, you're absolutely right that you should not be doing that, actually.
I think so. Priya is smiling from the floor.
Maybe combining two sets of patients, and that's not really is going to give you an answer.
Dr. Govind Babu's comment, a quick comment, please.
Yeah, I think this is a modality that has been underutilized. So, but unless we have evidence to that, you cannot recommend it routinely. But I think case-to-case basis, we have been doing it already.
Dr. Reena's quick comment, please.
I don't agree with Dr. Govind Babu because as a result of this study where we started in Tata Memorial, I see a shootout where all across the country people started without any evidence, they started giving chemotherapy and surgery. And it is also very disheartening in this study that 30% patient could not undergo surgery. So we have done disservice to these patients. I strongly believe that until there is any overall survival benefit, we should stop doing any chemotherapy followed by surgery, and we should practice the gold standard. I'm very, very strong about it.
I think I'm getting into trouble as a moderator.
It's unethical to practice.
I will be the most diplomatic moderator.
No, Rita, I didn't say routinely. I said in select patients we already
exactly what I wanted to evoke. I have managed to evoke that.
Across the country, I see this service being done to the patients. And it's really, really sad to see when the patients are being mismanaged because of these studies. It's good to do the study, but then this is really bad.
We have been managing these patients with concurrent chemo radiation for many years, and we have reached a plateau as far as the survival is concerned. Obviously, there is a need to investigate more
and find out. As I'm talking about the general practice patients being treated off the trial,
When she
says 30% of patients don't respond, madam, the same thing happens in ovarian cancer. No, in neoadjuvant chemotherapy, 20-30% will not respond in any such site.
So you can't compare ovary with chemo radiation.
I think we'll call it a day for this abstract here. Like a diplomatic moderator, I would say that we need to wait till 2019 with caution for the final results of URTC trial.
Till then, give.
Yes, but we have only 7.5 minutes, Supriya, so that comment has to really
I agree that systemic chemotherapy has a role, maybe not in neoadjuvant setting, because after concurrent chemoradiotherapy, we are getting excellent local control nowadays, but a vast majority of patients are also having distant relapses. I think we need to wait for trials.
Yeah, there's an interlaced trial which is happening, which you can add chemotherapy, but again, we have to wait for the results.
And of course, the TMH, chemotherapy the NSCT has a role. Trial. When are the final results expected of the NSCT trial?
18 or 19.
Fine. So there are various other trials which was presented in the abstract also. Neoadjuvant chemotherapy in various settings has been evaluated, but so far no impact on overall survival. Role of prophylactic extended field radiation towards the para-aortic nodal area, and mind you, the word prophylactic. So Dr. Sairam, what is your take on role of prophylactic extended field radiotherapy towards the para-aortic nodal stations?
I think we should not indulge on prophylactic, at least para-aortic nodal irradiation, because when we find para-aortic node and if we investigate further, we see a lot of the times already the distance is extended to mediastinum and other places. And the overall results after having given RT to the para-aortic nodes, there is not much difference in survival. Sure. So in a therapeutic setup itself, it is not showing any good benefit. So the role of prophylactic para-aortic nodal irradiation, I think, would add more toxicity than of any benefit, I feel.
Fine. So if we do not indulge in prophylactic, Dr. Sailashri or Dr. Tongaonkar, what should we indulge in then?
No, the problem with prophylactic is what do you call, when did you define prophylaxis as when you don't see nodes on your scans or your PET scans or your surgical staging. So the whole point of prophylaxis and micrometastasis, at the moment we have come to know that macrometastasis and micrometastasis are doing the same disadvantage to the patient. I'm not talking about circulating tumor cells, basically less than 2 micro whatever. So if you want to know micrometastasis in any area and if that has an impact on survival, whether you remove it or you give adjuvant radiotherapy to it, then we have to define what is prophylactic, what is the gold standard to call it prophylaxis. It's not seen in the scan, doesn't mean it is not there.
So any role for laparoscopic lymph node sampling or any surgical?
Well, surgical. I think surgical staging will certainly have a role in the future. Yes. I really feel that because the best of imaging modalities also have an accuracy of 65-70%, as Shaila said. So I think there is definitely a role, especially if the lymph nodes look enlarged. I think a quick laparoscopic lymph node sampling can certainly be done. Especially because now there are trials which show that addition of chemotherapy when the lymph parietic nodes are positive, in addition to extended field radiation, improves survival.
And also cervical cancer behaves in a very nice fashion of pelvic lymph nodes to parietic and then to supraclavicular and then it goes to the... So there is a definite way it behaves. So we're trying to track
Dr.
those.
Govind Babu, one quick question, sorry to interrupt. None of these patients received chemotherapy. Do you think chemo would have made their life worse and that these randomizations would not have been so simple the way they have presented?
I don't think it would have made it worse, but I think we need to select the patients also properly. You know, you just can't blanketly give the same chemo to everybody. So I think you need to choose your patients also right.
So
because even in the routine chemo radiotherapy that we give, if you don't choose your patient right, many of them are not completing either of the modalities.
Right. So can we take home that parietic prophylactic radiation has to be on case-to-case basis and not blanket, and whenever feasible, whenever suspicious, or if there is an PET uptake, consider surgical staging of the parietic nodal region. Can we conclude that as an audience?
Can I add one?
Sorry?
Prophylactic has no role. What you are saying is if nodes are positive.
Yeah.
Just
so
I can
so
add
prophylactic,
for
no. So probably that is the take-home message for this abstract.
So I feel we cannot say totally out. There will be, but the routine practice of radiotherapy is not very advanced technique. So if you use probably IMRT in future, maybe, and especially when Dr. Govind said about case selection, your patients who have pelvic nodes, those lower parietic, if carefully can be given, may have a future role. As of now, I agree that there is no role of prophylactic chemo radiation to parietic. But yes, there would be, because definitely these mechanisms showing there's less distant metastasis. Yeah. So we cannot say rule out, but yes, it should be investigational.
So we need future trials. We need probably future trials with better radiotherapy.
Chemotherapy
and better radiotherapic
yes.
techniques.
Please let me tell you that in patients with locally advanced cervical cancer, there's already a randomized trial comparing pelvic plus parietic radiation therapy versus concurrent chemo radiation therapy, yeah. and there is no difference. So I think if concurrent chemo radiation is given, I think parietic radiation therapy should be absolutely out at the present moment.
No.
Okay. I think Supriya is waiting. I saw Supriya in the Astro abstract. I mean, I'm waiting to ask this question to Supriya because the way she had dissected this abstract out at Astro this year, role of intensity modulator radiation therapy in improving quality of life. And this is an important abstract because it is adjuvant therapy in pelvis, not only cervical cancer specific. Of course, the abstract is cervical cancer. It has said that the GI and the GU toxicities in patients who underwent radiation with IMRT technique following surgery, they did better. But can I ask Supriya, do you agree with it? Or do you strongly agree with it?
I think that analysis was quite premature, and the way the study was designed was week 5 toxicity, and as we've seen with result, So basically what has happened out of that is that there is a toxicity difference at week 5, and you wait for 4 weeks, that difference disappears. IMRT costs 1.2 lakhs in India, and 3DCRT 15,000 at least in our hospital. So I don't think we can recommend it. And as far as our trial is concerned, I think we'll have to wait for another 2-3 years.
No, but you know, this trial, even before Astro happened, the news release, the press release, this was, you know, really marketed well in the US.
It was marketed
very well in the US. So do you have a take on that?
So there's another news you should read in Medscape after the abstract.
Yes, really.
And I can also add that the primary endpoint is just acute toxicity, which is seconds by 6 weeks. More important is the late toxicity, the small bowel toxicity, which happens with radiation, and also bowel and bladder toxicity. So like these effects have to be studied more carefully, and so many patients present with subacute intestinal obstruction, lymphedema. All these things have not been accounted in this study. We just can't say acute toxicity is important. I feel late toxicities are more important.
So since we are short of time and we are going to conclude the session, I just one last point. In the adjuvant chemo radiation trial, you know, that was a very strong message of which was dissected while presentation, of course. I went through the trial, the structure of the trial. they have projected the word negative lymph node. So they were all negative lymph node patient, but all of them had two risk factor: interstitial infiltration more than 1/3, LVI size more than 4 cm, and nerve involvement. And those patients did better with chemotherapy. So you know that was not a magic. Those patients were any which way supposed to do better with chemotherapy. So the take-home messages, if everyone agrees, this could be the take-home messages. For low resource setting, strategies have to be optimized without significantly compromising patient outcomes. In the NACT trial, EORTC, significant proportions of patients cannot complete surgery due to chemotherapy toxicities, and we have decided that we will patiently wait till 2019. Role of prophylactic extended field radiation towards the paraotic nodal area still needs to be evaluated in a concurrent chemotherapy setting. Dr. Tongaokar says that if you are doing concurrent chemo radiation setting, paraotic is not necessary unless there is a nodal uptake there. Point well taken. IMRT appears to be promising in the adjuvant setting of pelvic radiation. Of course, there are counterpoints to that. And addition of chemo in early stage cervical cancer to radiotherapy has shown promise, but there were a lot of factors involved in that trial, and that needs to be evaluated with caution. So with this, can we conclude the panel if all our panelists agree?
Yes.